So, ready?
Ready.
Okay. Tonight is September 12th, and welcome to the Committee of the Whole and Special Meeting of the Board of Education, District 64. Vicki, please take the roll.
Mark Agaman.
Here.
Bob Johnson.
Here.
Vicki Lee is here. Tony Borelli.
Here.
Scott Zimmerman.
Who will be here.
Dathan Paterno.
Here.
And Tom Soto.
Here.
Okay, so tonight we have a Committee of the Whole and a special meeting. Committee of the Whole will be talking about budgetary changes and the NIPSTA evaluation and changes to the security, comprehensive security plan. And the committee and the special meeting will be talking about, in particular, the Carpenter roof, but we have a couple of other assorted smaller items. But before we get into that, we have other items to talk about, such as I have a motion to go into closed session to further discuss issues surrounding the PREA contract under Illinois Compile Statutes 5-122C2. Three board members have a right and have asked for a special session under Board Policy 2200 to discuss specific issue regarding the timing of the release of the contract. While the contract is currently tentative, in other words, still under review and not on a finalized version, we are still under the exception of the closed meeting rules. We also have an issue regarding employee salary, and we'll discuss this under 5 Illinois Compile Statutes 122C1. Are there any questions?
And I guess we'd also probably give an update on the Teacher Assistance Association.
We'll include that under the 5 Illinois Compile Statute 122C1.
Yes.
2C2. Any other questions? Okay. I need a second. Second?
Second.
Okay. We need an oral starting with Mark.
Yes.
Aye.
Aye.
Yes.
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. In our audience and our video viewers, the special meeting Committee of the Whole for the Board of Education, District 64. The board has already spent well over an hour in discussion of issues surrounding 5 Illinois Compile Statute 122C2 involving the PREA negotiations and 5 Illinois Compile Statutes 122C1 employee salary structure. Tonight we have a Committee of the Whole on security updates and comprehensive security plan that was asked of administration approximately 10 months ago. Part of that plan was the inclusion of secured vestibules, one of which has just recently been completed and is in use at Washington School. Anybody who desires more information regarding the new security vestibules can and should review the district website for more information. Our Committee of the Whole also includes a public review of the tentative budget in preparation for a vote to accept that budget. The board will hear any comments on the budget tonight, as well as on 9/26, which also be the date of the voting to accept that final budget. As our next board meeting following the 9/26 is in October, September 26th date is the latest allowable date by law to accept the budget for academic year 16/17. Absent a special meeting of the board. The special meeting tonight will be to vote on corrections necessary to fix the Carpenter roof. Been reported to the board and public of the severe degeneration of the roof decking structure at Carpenter, identified only while the roof was being prepped for replacement. A new roof subfloor has been bid out, and the board will hear of the bids and costs involved to make this area watertight and safe for children and staff. Following the replacement of the roof deck, the replacement of the roofing materials will proceed as scheduled. Our next full meeting will be on 9/26 and will include, among other items, the acceptance of the budget as well as enrollment for staffing information. I will withhold some of my further comments in the President's message in order to save some time, and we'll move right into our Committee of the Whole. Dr. Hey. Hines?
Thank you. Joining me tonight are two representatives from NIPSTA, our safety and security partners. Jill Raymaker is the director at NIPSTA, and if you want to start by just giving a little brief bio about yourself, that would be wonderful, and then I'll have Sam do the same.
Sure. Thank you so much, and it's our pleasure to be here with the board again tonight. My name is Jill Benson Raymaker. I'm the executive director of the Northeastern Illinois Public Safety Training Academy. NIPSTA has been in place since 2001, and I've been at NIPSTA for the past 2 years. My background is in disaster healthcare. I spent 24 years at North Shore University Health System and have been the executive director at NIPSTA again for 2 years. It's my pleasure to introduce Sam Patino to you.
Hi, good evening. My name is Sam Patino. I'm a retired deputy chief of police from Evanston, Illinois. I was formerly the security director at Evanston High School and work as a private consultant in security in schools.
All right, Dr. Lopez, if you could advance the slide, and Jill, if you wouldn't mind just briefly letting the board and the community know a little bit about NIPSTA, type of organization you are, and some of the areas of your areas of focus.
Thank you. So NIPSTA, again, is a Northeastern Illinois Public Safety Training Academy. We're located in the Glen, in Glenview, been there since 2001. And our primary area of effort is in training for public safety personnel. That includes all of the whole spectrum. So it's fire service, law enforcement, public works, disaster medical, and now we are, with our Center for Security and Life Safety, reaching out to those other areas of the community that really could use our assistance, like municipalities and schools. And so it's been our pleasure to work with Dr. Hines and her team for about the last 10 months in taking a look at the disaster procedures and policies that they had in place, and then doing some training, which we'll tell you about in just a moment.
Wonderful. If you could advance the slide, and I'll stop hitting this microphone. It makes a horrible noise. So as Ms. Raymaker said, about 10 or 11 months ago, the board had asked that we put together a comprehensive safety and security plan that moved beyond just the notion of enhancing security at our schools via secure vestibules, but to really look again comprehensively at what systems we have in place, what additional systems we should be putting in place, and then prioritizing those systems and just continuing on an annual basis to make the district safer and safer, while keeping in mind that we do educate children, so we don't want the schools to feel as though their penitentiaries are too institutionalized. So the focus of tonight's presentation is going to be really what the committee has been working on for 10 months, but before I jump into that, I'm going to take you back just a little bit and do a recap. For board members, you read a lot of this information in the written board report. There are a few new features that we will share within this presentation. So, as you know, it was at your directive that we began to really look more comprehensively at safety and security in the district. I always say, other than educating children, keeping them safe while they're at school is one of our top priorities. So prior to my arrival in 2014, the district had commissioned a physical security audit with Rita Security back in 2013. That security audit did provide the Board of Education as well as district administration with recommendations to spend significant time, resources, and thought to which of those recommendations they wanted to put into action and over what period of time. So when I started, one of the things that I did was I reviewed that document, and for those of you that were on the board that hired me, you know that many of those recommendations found their way into my first year roadmap. And I had that 1 year roadmap as a placeholder until we wrote the strategic plan that now is in its second year of operation here in the district. One of the overarching recommendations within the Rita security audit findings were the notion, the top recommendation really was to secure the vestibules. And that was proposed last year. And some agree with that. Some agree with that recommendation. Some do not. But the board did approve to have one secure vestibule installed, as Dr. Borelli mentioned, at Washington School. We had one of our recent board meetings there, where members of the board, administration, and even a community member walked the vestibule with us. And we feel as though we've made a giant step forward, especially at Washington, in making the building more secure. But we really, beyond the vestibule, we really kept asking ourselves, what more can we do to ensure our schools are as safe as they can be? And the more we asked ourselves that question, the more we knew we needed some partners. And that's how I tracked down NIPSTA. And I've been thrilled with their partnership ever since. If you could advance, oh, you're already there. At Institute Day, back in August, it's already been a month, hard to believe, we had NIPSTA representatives in different classrooms working with all of our teachers and staff to help really start crafting a new message and really doing what many would refer to as a paradigm shift. And it's going to be a slow shift, but it's one that we think is very important to make sure our schools continue to become safer and safer places to educate kids. And it's that notion of that we are all first responders until our community first responders arrive to help us. The police, although they're close to our schools, they said they need probably 4 to 5 minutes to get to us in the event of an emergency, so we're going to need to have staff that have been trained and are confident in mobilizing human and other resources to respond to a crisis situation. So we began making that shift in the minds of our staff, hopefully back on August 15th. through training, and we will talk at length tonight about the training that we have already begun and will continue, but really helping people through training and conversation be prepared to take an active role in an emergency and not just wait and assume somebody else will do it. And the goal then, and NIPSTA really, this is kind of one of their mantras, the consistency of operation and standardizing procedures is a goal and is something that we don't currently have, but we are committed to bringing to all of the schools across the district. The next set of slides will really be led by both Jill and Sam, and they're going to talk about their method of doing just that, that incident command system, what it is, why it's important, and how it's really the foundation now of the newly minted emergency operation plan. Joe?
Thank you. So when you think about what an incident command system is, it's been around for since about the 70s, the early 80s, started based on wildfires in California, and has now spread across the country as really being the gold standard for how to mitigate and respond to an incident of all sizes. Next slide, please. What makes the incident command so important is that this is a standardized approach. It is the same type of education that is received not only in schools, but in fire departments, police departments, municipal government, volunteer organizations, any type of disaster response personnel, all have the same level of training. And we identified that after September 11th, that was critical. And so what's important to know also for the board is that not only is it the knowledge important, but any kind of access to grant funding, you have to make sure that all of your staff has been trained in incident command training. And so we really started that process back in February by introducing this concept to your core team and continued it again tonight. We just completed a 2-hour training session for about 22 of your staff members, your senior staff members, to go through incident command in schools. And so why is it so important? It's a very standardized approach to command and control. It includes some basic terminology and operating procedures and best practices. But what's really so important is that consistency of operation during a crisis, that we know that by training the people that are going to be responding to a crisis, they could be filling multiple different types of roles. We need to have that redundancy built in. That is what's going to make the response and then the recovery from an incident so valuable. We love the fact that Incident Command manages multiple different types of incidents. And as Dr. Hines will talk about, the work that we've done to help to really ramp up your protocols, your response policies, means that you can respond to any different type of hazard or any different type of incident the same way. And so it's that consistency of approach, not only with your senior teams, but then across all of your schools, that is so invaluable. To being able to manage these situations. And really, I want to reiterate and reemphasize the fact that this is that transition point to take the staff members really to that level of first responder. And it's a paradigm shift, and it's really been quite challenging, and we knew that was going to be the case. But I'm so proud of what the staff has done to just buy into this being an ongoing process now for many, many years to come.
So as Jill said, last year we spent some time in 207. We used their facility, and Jill and her team trained many of the administrative team in this incident command methodology. Today, from 4 to 6, before we went into closed sessions, all of the administrators were, again, with Jill and Sam, and we received the 100-level training series. And then what's going to happen here from that point is we're really going to be looking at our building crisis teams. And I would say there's commonality amongst our crisis teams across the buildings and across the district, but they don't all function in the same way. So we really want to build, as we're trying to do across this whole district, instead of a system of schools, a school system, we really want to revamp our crisis team members and establish a very clear and consistent purpose. Our crisis teams, we're going to standardize membership, how frequently they meet, and we're going to have just very consistent agendas that we're going to make sure that we cover and that we refine and we reflect on the process in the same manner as a district. Even though they'll be building-based, they'll be more similar than different. Saying that, though, we know that each building's plans are going to be somewhat nuanced because of the size of their facility. Some are 2-story, some are 1-story, some are 3 stories, the age of the kids, and so on and so forth. The physical location of some of our schools are on a busy highway versus nested in the neighborhood. So there will be some differences based on location, but for the most part, our goal is to build greater consistency. And we're going to provide ongoing training to build capacity to react to these what we hope will be very few crisis situations, but when they come into play, we want to have swift action, clear direction, and we want to have staff members doing so with confidence. So the building crisis team crisis teams will be going out to NIPSTA in the coming weeks. We'll have an elementary training and a middle school training. It's a fun facility. It's where firemen and policemen are trained, so there's all kinds of rigs and scenario situations where that we can move through. But they will then go through the 100-level training, which is a very eye-opening, somewhat daunting training because it really spells out very specifically how to act and what incident command roles everyone should establish. And it's just going to train everybody. And the conversation we had prior to coming into closed was, what if, you know, some of our staff members are no longer interested in being on this crisis team anymore because we're really upping the ante in terms of what we expect from them. They won't really be able to just passively wait until someone else takes over the situation. We're going to be asking them to get involved. So that is going to be something that we're going to have to talk to our crisis members about and really help them see the importance of making this this shift in thinking. Because again, we got into education not only to teach kids, but it's because we want to make sure that they're safe while they're with us. So I think once we move through training, they're going to feel less anxious and more willing to kind of dive in when needed. So next, Jill, if you want to just talk a teeny bit, if there's anything you want to add in terms of your preparedness training and what you think this might look like beyond 100 and then when we do 700 in terms of the multi-year process.
Sure. So as we discussed earlier, this is really a change in the culture for the organization. And what is so wonderful about this is that we're saying the training is ongoing because the process is ongoing. And we want to make sure, we have a saying at NIPSTA, we don't train till we get it right, we train till we can't get it wrong. And that's very important because we know that everybody reacts in a very different way under stress. And we understand that. And so what we're trying to do is to build the confidence level of the staff members at all different levels to be able to step in multiple different roles. Next slide, please. Here's a list, and it's not the complete list, but I think it shows you the work that my team has done with Dr. Hines' team to make sure that we have everything covered as much as we possibly can. So we're trying to pre-plan, trying to think of as many different possibilities and potentials to be out there. But these are some of the procedures that the staff has worked on to create some very streamlined, not complicated, not complex, but just a streamlined approach to as many different scenarios that we could think about coming forward. So really the goal is now to integrate this type of preparedness training into the culture of District 64, to have training that takes place that doesn't require 8 or 10 hours in a classroom, but perhaps maybe a 15-minute conversation on a routine basis is what's going to really integrate these plans into your culture.
And at your seat, you have the almost a complete emergency operation plan, but you also have a sample annex, and it's a tornado annex. We practice during our safety weeks. We're currently practicing where we go, what procedures we follow, the cover position that the children go into, and so you have a sample annex. We've written over 25 of these, and they're as comprehensive as this. They follow a very similar flow, purpose, scope, responsibilities, what are the, bless you, specialized procedures, both indoor and outdoor. And it's been quite a bit of work, not only for NIPSTA, but they draft it, they send it to our team, we put it into more educational terms, and then we kind of arm wrestle a little, what can we keep in, oh, you took that out, that really needs to stay, and we now have reached consensus on 25 annexes, some of which we'll never publish because there are internal procedures that we wouldn't want folks on the exterior to know, but part of our training, once we go through the basics of 100, will be to orient our building crisis teams to these annexes, and then having that team of teachers and faculty help us figure out how we're going to expose the entire staff to all of these annexes. So again, they start thinking along these lines. So that's going to be part of the multi-year process. That will not, it sounds easy, but we're believing it's going to take some time to do. Okay. If you could advance Dr. Lopez through tornadoes, and there we go. So we have been working, as you know, since last year to continue to enhance safety here in the district. Go forward, sorry, Laura. Mm-hmm. All right, so some of the things that we've done, this summer, we put impact-resistant film to all the building entryways, and that was a big process, but it is one that we feel is very important in terms of making the windows that are within our doors and our entryways much stronger and by having that resistant film added to the windows. We've added more Sonatrol card swipe locations across all of our buildings. We have more interior and exterior cameras than we did when we gave you an update on security last year. We've already mentioned Washington's vestibule, and we hope it will become the model for the future, but we know that's going to be a discussion point with this board, and we intend to have an initial discussion with you in terms of forwarding our recommendation to secure all of our vestibules at our COW on facilities in October. Panic buttons have been installed in all of our offices, and we do know that they work because we did have a child accidentally press one the other day while he was sitting at a secretary's desk. And the police came ready to help us as if it were a serious crisis situation. They arrived within 3 minutes, so we know their response time is as they say it will be. We have now hold open alarms, and I know this was a point of significant discussion with the board, one or two members in particular, but we have hold open alarms now linked to all of our office monitors on all of our doors. And they really do let you know that the door is open. And we're right now working to see how long we want the doors to be allowed to open before the alarm sounds. For example, as children are entering and exiting doors, the office is being inundated with the sounds of the hold open alarm. So we're kind of figuring out what the right amount of time it's going to take to get a couple hundred kids in through each of the doors that we're allowing kids to enter. But that system has been added, and we know it works. I think it's a good addition.
Will that system allow for the balance between hours where we expect 300 kids to be flowing through and then hours where we expect nobody, to where we can have a 25-minute hold open bypass during the morning hours and afternoon hours when kids are coming in and out, but a one-second bypass for when those doors should never be open at all?
That's the question that we have asked the company, and we are working to see if we can set the systems differently based on time of day. So that was one of the questions we heard from all the secretaries, because they're the ones listening. We are moving to a standard safety week in District 64, where all of our more significant safety routines are practiced up front. So we do lockdown once police attend. We do fire drills, we do evacuation drills, and we're doing them at the beginning of the year now instead of waiting until where you would typically do a tornado drill would be in the spring. We'll revisit them seasonally, but we want to front load the key safety drills so everybody is aware of the routines and procedures and where to go. Early on, when I think back to my first year in district, on the first day of school, one of our schools had a rolling brownout and smoke in the third floor, and the fire alarm was triggered, and the police did come, and or the fire department came. We had to evacuate 600 kids on the first day of school. Very few knowing, many in a new location in the building, kind of where to go and how to get out. So now we're doing it earlier, so the likelihood of kids being caught unaware of what to do in an emergency is lessened. Okay, additionally, Mr. DeGeorge is working with the architects to have new maps. These updated maps have been developed through the work of the Health Life Safety Survey that is available, that was produced and are now available for each room, showing color-coded evacuation routes. And in some cases, they're rerouting rooms into different directions based on capacity, trying to exit down any one hallway or through any one stairwell. We've to be installed in the coming weeks. That will happen by the custodial group in each of the classrooms. And they're much more clear to read, and they just look a lot more now in terms of their ease of understanding. Future work with the architects will be to establish both primary and secondary routes of evacuation and shelter-in-place locations. So, for example, Jefferson has always gone to Our Lady of Ransom. And there are 3- and 4-year-olds that are here. That's quite a ways. But now with the installation of Prospect Park, we're reaching out to Prospect Park to see if Jefferson can evacuate and use that off-site location. It's closer for little legs to walk there. So we're constantly revisiting our shelter-in-place locations. We're also making sure that we put in place an annual check-in with these facilities to make sure they still are happy that we're coming, are willing to take us, that they have a true understanding of what it might look like if 600 kids descended on their facility. We're talking about the possibility of having water and potentially some type of a snack, like a granola bar that would last a year. In the event we have to keep kids off-site for an extended period of time, we can at least offer them a little something to eat and drink. So we're just getting a little more in-depth in terms of not just having a location, but being in greater communication with the off-site locations. We're also in conversation to decide if we should have kids and teachers practice walking to those off-site locations. You know, if you're trying to mobilize a large school with 650 elementary kids or almost 800 middle schoolers, and we're going to take a walking trip, you know, through the community to get to our off-site location, what is that going to look like, feel like? It's not going to be easy. So we're debating if we'd like to do some practice relocation drills. You go to the next slide, Laura. We also have a Crisis Go app. It's a mobile crisis management tool that really is designed to improve communication and emergency response. What I'm most thrilled about, that it's no more binders. We have large crisis binders that there's one per building. Now we're gonna have everything we need in terms of our checklists, maps, documents, emergency contacts, right here on our phones. It also can work with a tablet, an iPad, or a laptop. So we're gonna, Laura, if you could indulge just a little, we're going to, and MJ, you might have to help us, but we have a little demo, so you get a sense. Then is the binder, now is the iPhone or Galaxy. This went from a few people being in the know and having the notion of being the incident commander or the person in charge to look at all those happy people. Everyone is involved in helping make sure that that when we have an emergency situation, people are confident, they're trained, and they're pitching in to help. Okay, MJ, are you going to run the demo? All right, here we go.
What if everyone in your district had their emergency plan with them? What if your emergency response team had effective communication tools to use during a crisis? With Crisis Go, they can. It's a cross-platform crisis response system. Smarter crisis technology that revolutionizes how school districts respond to crisis today. Tools in the hands of first responders so they know exactly what to do in active crisis situations. Case in point, Mrs. Sanders has just been notified that there's an intruder in the building. Quickly, she accesses her checklist and starts completing action steps to protect the students. Using the video communication platform, the principal can share a video of a dangerous condition caused by a recent storm. Likewise, transportation accidents can be communicated quickly to the team. It's important to communicate the right message to the right community. And it's easy to build a plan online with a web portal and native apps on all devices. Integrated into existing plans and drills, Crisis Go can assist first responders during a crisis. Crisis Go allows you to plan, act, communicate, and report affordably. Doing everything we can to keep our students safe. Crisis Go.
Other than the pitch at the end, what we like about it is all the things that the previous slides, you know, prior to the last one, puts everything just in your hands at all times to expedite communication and checklist.
This is in addition to the binder.
Well, we're not even going to have a binder anymore. We're going to get to the website that we're developing, so you can pass through that slide, Laura.
But there's going to be something, I'm sure that you guys took into consideration, there's going to be something in case internet's
right.
unavailable.
We'll have
or,
copies of it.
Yeah, in case internet's unavailable
mm-hmm.
or,
yes,
you know.
We have talked about that. Good question. So we have a new security website. It's a comprehensive overview of our safety and security for the public, so it has a public face, what we feel as though they can and should know. And if you want to click on that link, you can just can take a quick look at it. Safety and security. So each of those red bands, you can go and get background and goals. If you want to just click on background and goals, MJ, or Lori, who's ever driving. So there's the background, our 10-year health, life, safety. Those green areas are live links, pictures of the vestibule, as Dr. Borelli talks about, some of the enhancements. And it really explains in the beginning paragraph how strategic objectives 5 and 6 have to do with facilities and finance. So it's kind of looping this work back to or tying it to our strategic plan. So this is under development. I would say we're probably about 80% or so done with it at this point, and we'll just continue over the next week or two. Allison and Bernadette have really been working quite hard on day two to get this new website up and running. Response plans and procedures will be password protective and linked to our staff portal. So what we think the community can and should see, they'll be able to, and what needs to be just kept for safety purposes to staff members will be password protective. Okay. Last year we talked to you about we made crisis go guides, little yellow spirals, and we put them in the hands of every teacher. Because prior to last year, again, we didn't have a document that every teacher had in their classroom that hit on the couple of 5, 6, 10 most likely scenarios and how to act. So now last year, everybody was given one of those. And, you know, Sam has said over and over, that is still the go-to classroom reference. Those are Sam's words and quotes there. But we want to continue to review the content annually so people know what is expected and that they're then comfortable, again, stepping up when we need them to, should there be a crisis. And they have been standardized, as I said last year, by the door. And we are making sure now that teachers are including this information in their substitute plan, so the substitutes know to look for it in the event of an emergency. And then Mr. Martin, who trains our substitutes, is going to add this information and the review of crisis procedures to his initial sub-training for when our new staff, new subs are trained annually in the fall. Go to the next one. Thank you. So through our research and collaborative work, we have identified two areas that need attention and support from all staff to make them a reality. We did go over this these expectations with staff back in August. Active supervision while students are outside. And much like some of the other points we've covered that were very near and dear to certain board members, this was one that another couple board members really wanted to know. What are we doing in terms of kids being outside? And we all know, because we're parents ourselves, there's no way we can keep our kids protected at all times when we're out at a restaurant, when they're playing in the front yard. But we really worked with NIPSTA to say what is within our locus of control? What can we think about and put in place to shore up what's happening with kids in terms of safety when we're outside? So we want to make sure that when staff take kids outside that they let the office know. The office tracks who's outside. They make sure that they have a radio with them outside and a radio that's working. And we started talking to the staff a lot about this notion of active supervision, which means if the playground, we could break it into four quadrants, and there were four supervisors. Everybody knows what quadrant they're responsible for supervising, and they're actively rotating around that quadrant, watching kids, watching the perimeter, and just making sure that they have a real sense of who's on the premises and who's not on the premises. One of the other things we've been talking about, and we don't know how it will be received, is right now our playgrounds, people are playing on the playgrounds all day. Moms, babysitters, grandparents, kids that live in the neighborhood. And we really started asking ourselves, you know, in some districts they don't allow anybody on school playgrounds while school's in session, because you want to limit how many people are around your facility that really don't work there or belong there. After school, once kids are gone, you know, please come enjoy our playgrounds. You know, they're wonderful. So that is a conversation that we're having internally. We know it would be a tough one for some members of the community to accept. That, hey, what do you mean you're not letting kids, neighborhood kids, play at our schools? But it is the recommendation of our partners and certainly, you know, informed practice in other districts that you want to have as few kind of unauthorized, if you will, folks on the ground as possible when kids are out and about playing either at recess or as part of the PE program. So that's something that we're continuing to grapple with. And we will mention it to our PTA, PTO presidents when we meet with them either tomorrow or the next day, tomorrow. And just, they're going to be our first litmus test to see their response, and more to come on that. We also realized that we didn't have any field trip or off-campus event procedures in place. other than that the teachers had their class lists with them and they brought a phone, because, you know, who doesn't carry their phone anymore? But we have, Sam has sent us some sample procedures, and Dr. Lopez and I are working to kind of take the best of the best. We're not afraid to steal shamelessly from those that have done good work before us, to put some field trip procedures in place and off-campus events. So, for example, a few years ago, PTA had a sponsored event in the evening. They had a fog machine that set off the fire. Kids loved the fog machine. It was great. It enhanced the spooky party. But then, you know, the fire department came and nobody knew who to call or how to get out, or, you know, so we know that we have to have some type of off-campus and after-hour event procedures and routines. So we're working on, we've got them in draft form. We're going to be seeking staff input. Certainly the staff takes the kids on the field trips. We want them to weigh in on our best thinking, but more to come on that. So that's something that we're continuing to work with this year.
What about Christmas sings, and where the buildings are opened up for everybody to come in? I mean, that's going to be that much more difficult to try and organize, I imagine.
Right. So what we did last year is we tried to limit access points to just one point within the building, and we did have members of our local law enforcement team, our building liaisons or our building buddies, they were present at the sing. And, in one case, Joel and I had to report to a school. There was a parent that didn't have authorization to be on premises, and we were there proactively, knowing that this parent typically does show up at such events, even though there's a court order that says they're not to. And we were there to provide a layer of redirection, and the police were there in the event that we needed further assistance, but Joel and I handled it. We didn't need any further backup. But it is something that is of concern, because what some districts will do, and when I was a principal years back, we did do this. We raptured everyone. Folks that were coming in advance, we would advertise, if you plan to come to the sing and you can stop by the school prior to the sing, pop in, bring your license, we'll run you. And then we had a table for people that were already in the system, and they got their badge, and then we had multiple people raptoring folks. That, as you can imagine, my school was, you know, smaller than the schools that we have here. It took quite a bit, because you're raptoring grandparents, moms and dads. They don't have a license, so we're not raptoring little people, but they're siblings. But it takes time. So we really feel as though that what we put in place last year, ushering everybody through one entry point, having local responders and administrators present to help identify folks that are or are not supposed to be there. And if there's more that you think we can be doing, you know, we are open to hear it. But those are some of the things we put in place last year. So this last slide, we used an institute day as well. You know, we're asking the staff to be observant, prepared, know your emergency offsite locations. That notion of active supervision, instead of kids are playing and you're connecting with your colleague while you're outside at recess. Really watch the kids, watch the perimeter. Stay informed of changes in the procedures. Know that crisis go guide, and that remember this, again, this mantra, you are a first responder until our first responders arrive. That's where we're headed. That's our goal. So that is our presentation. It's where we've been over the last 10 months. We feel as though, and I think NIPSTA would echo, this is going to be a process that's going to evolve over the next 10 months and the next 10 months after that, because we're constantly looking for ways to improve and enhance what we're doing here in district. Anything else, Jill or Sam? No? Questions from the board? We've got experts here, and now would be a good time. If you have questions or additional direction for us, we're open to hear it.
What is the amount of time? I know it's going to be, the training is going to be ongoing, but would the training be broken up into, you know, if you do it one whole day, the first day of the school year, things get lost because you're not using them. You know, we hope that these serious occurrences don't happen. And if they don't happen, I mean, if they do happen, it's training all by itself, right? But if they don't happen and you do it once in the beginning of the year, it seems to me that's not enough reinforcement by the end of the year. So what time frame, numbers of occurrences do you feel would be appropriate? Twice a year, split it up? Once a year, five times a year? How do you do that?
this.
So the major training certainly can take place once or twice a year, like Dr. Hines has already illustrated. But I think really if you're changing the culture, which is what you have absolutely started to do, the more often you can have these conversations and these discussions on a monthly basis, on a staff meeting, a small discussion basis, just to say, you know, today we're going to just talk a little bit about what do we do if there's the weather suddenly turns very severe. What's our first sort of five things that we're going to do. If you make that part of what they do every day or every week or every month, I think that's the key. The key is just getting that conversation moving consistently as often as possible. That breeds some more just feelings of security for each of the people that are working here.
Thank you.
And I would agree with what Jill has said. The principals will use their early release Wednesdays and or staff meeting time to make sure that we're doing little mini PD throughout the course of the year. The 100 training will be important for that team, and then much like what we're doing with our SMART goal setting, we had the core cohort one, and then we added people to cohort two, and in the second year we'll add additional folks in year three to continue to build that capacity and to spread the scope of informed individuals that have that deeper training. We'll probably follow a similar model with the emergency preparedness training.
Okay.
Yeah, I think you're just doing a fantastic job in terms of, you know, I think where the board had expressed, as you said, a desire for security to be have a much more comprehensive security plan. I think you're all doing a great job here of really taking that to a level of detail and action that I don't think necessarily we would have expected maybe to happen this quickly. So I think.
Thank you. Because sometimes I know I can speak for the whole team when I said we felt like we were shooting at a moving target. We didn't necessarily know, you know, exactly what this was going to look like. So we feel like we're getting a little more focused and we're making some progress. But it's been a big undertaking in addition to everything else that was in the strategic plan that is supposed to be the governing document. This was like an additional layer on top of it. So they call this work detention when they come to my office because we spend hours doing it, and I guess it's about as pleasant as a detention, but we know it's important. So we really are focused time and resources. So, and very happy to have our NIPSTA partners guiding us.
Yeah, my hat's off to you. I sensed a couple times when you said a few board members this was important to them. You didn't look at me because you knew you've heard me say it so many times. So, but I guess I think it's outstanding. I love this. It's. I haven't read this new document that you handed
and
us.
And I apologize. That's fine. That should have gone on the wiki. So
it's okay. I'll read through it now. But
for that one.
But glancing through it, it looks outstanding. The one question, or the one thing I might say is much like it's really important to talk to the teachers on a periodic or regular intervals, whether that's monthly or weekly, I don't think it would be a bad idea that if there's ways to report on how this is being implemented and whether alarms are being triggered at doors and should we change things, or, you know, I'm not saying we got to spend a half an hour every, you know, month talking about this, but I think, you know, if in 6 months or something you could come back with an update or just an FYI update in the board book,
sure.
I think reporting back to us about how some of these things are being implemented, some of the things you're finding, where you need to change course, it's helpful for all of us because
sure.
It gives us a perspective of what's being done and a sense of where it is. And you know, I know I'm personally interested in some of those alarms being open and reports about the trip rate and how often that happens, because that gives me a sense of what the problems are.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Not hearing about it, but saying, wow, look at that. These are being tripped this often. Maybe these procedures make some sense. So to the extent there could be regular reports, I'd encourage it if the rest of the board thought it was a good idea.
Okay. I can do a comment out like I usually do a Friday memo and future meetings.
Yeah, every couple months would be fine.
You know, this doesn't pertain necessarily to the comprehensive plan here that we're talking about. And I do appreciate the effort that went into this. When we first asked of the administration to do this, it was, well, we have a plan, but it turns out we don't have a plan. We do have a plan now.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And it's a very concise plan, and everybody's going to follow it. But, you know, I guess I have a question, and then I'm going to follow that up. So are we still utilizing the 2013 Reader Report as the basis of our model for security going forward?
I would say yes. We use that too as a significant data point when we developed the strategic plan in terms of what we wanted to do with strategic objectives, you know, 5 and or 6. We have also shared that report with our more current partners, NIPSTA, and they, I think, completely endorsed the physical security survey that was done by Rita, and they didn't disagree with any of her findings. And Sam, if you want to jump in, because you spent a lot of time looking at it.
I happen to know Mr. Tim, who's the principal at Rita Security. He's a nationally known expert in physical security at schools. When I was at Evanston High School, I hired him to do the same security report that you had done here. He's the best guy to do this, and I would recommend that you try and eliminate all his considerations as you go along. Obviously, there's financial concerns with that, but you should be looking to enact all his recommendations because it's all about prevention is the reality of this. And secure vestibules and prevention are going to be key in reducing incidents of violence or other incidents in school.
Regarding that report, did your group have any additions to that report, or did you feel that report was comprehensive enough?
I thought the report was comprehensive. You know, additions are going to occur based on situations that you might find in the future. Nothing's, you know, it's all in a state of flux. So,
I think a couple of things you added were these amnionexes, and then the NIMS and the IC100 training for schools.
Right.
I don't think that Rita, if I remember correctly, had a very heavy focus on either of those points, and I think that those were two wonderful and essential additions that you kind of steered us in that direction.
The Rita report concentrates primarily on physical security, not training and expertise in areas of emergency management. That's where our expertise is. So along with the physical security component, there's training, the emergency operations plan. It's going to come full circle with a comprehensive plan.
And that's really getting to the crux of my question is, you know, I understand the comprehensive plan is more about process. And the fiscal security plan is going to come from Rita. So I guess my question is, where are we now currently, or by what date will we have 100% of that plan completed, or are we 90% completed? You know, we've done so many things.
Sure.
It'd be nice to know where we are landing with our obligations to complete those recommendations.
I think the big one, I think we've done all the small add-ons, the film, the cameras, the fobs, the big elephant in the room are the vestibules. That was something in 2013 that, you know, Paul Timms was surprised we hadn't done a decade prior. So it's now 2016, we're staring down 2017 before, you know, we probably go through enough of a conversation with the board to see where they want to go in the future. That's probably the big one. I can certainly pull the report and really do kind of a complete check off, but I know that's the big one.
Yeah, I realize that, but we have numerous buildings, and if you apply that report to every building, you know, I just want to make sure the T's are crossed and the
sure.
I's are dotted for all of those points for all of the buildings in our district, so we know that all the physical necessities have been covered. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, you'll be working on the process, and we'll know that's covered. And by all accounts, I think we've made great strides doing both of those.
I can put that on October.
Yeah.
That'd
be great.
Okay.
I know we just got this and I had quick review of it, but anywhere in this plan does it discuss non-emergency situations where we're talking about the everyday entering and exiting of the schools by the children before the bell, after the bell, during the bell, and then throughout the school day? Because I don't think I read it in here. I breezed through it pretty quick, but I didn't see anything in here that said, in the morning at Franklin School, the children will enter through door 1, 3, 5, and 7. They will do it between these hours. After this hour, that door shall not be opened. It shall remain closed until the students exit on this specific day, or at this specific hour. And then once the children have 30 minutes to exit, after that, all children should be directed to a different door to exit. Parents need to know this. I need
right.
to know
Did
where
we,
to pick up my
was
child.
Was there a slide? I thought that was in one of the slides. And Luann or Bernadette, because you've been in detention a lot. Didn't we have a slide saying that that was something that was kind of a next step? Did it
yes.
not? Well, because it's a good, it's the right question to ask. And if we didn't have it in this slide, it was to be there. Maybe we advanced past it. But, you know, two things that are at the top of my list with this board is, where are we with the vestibules? So we're going to have many conversations over a course of numerous meetings to come to terms with, you know, if we're going to build any more and so on and so forth. The next thing will be the entrance and exit procedures. So because we do that in a different manner, the principals have been helping us understand how many doors, just how many doors folks are currently exiting and entering in, and it's a staggering number. Sam is nodding and smiling because, you know, it's their recommendation that we, you know, have one, maybe two, that we funnel kids through.
How many do we funnel kids through at Washington with a vestibule and curling in place?
Two.
So, okay, but we didn't make the hallways any bigger.
Nope.
We just created a vestibule.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I guess the reason I'm asking this question is, you know, my feeling about vestibules. I love them. I just don't love the cost of them.
Right.
So if for me to get over that, I would think we would want to implement the Washington plan of two doors now. Let's watch it happen for a while before we have to decide on spending millions of dollars on vestibules, because there's a possibility that cutting down to two doors will be enough and we won't have to do vestibules, or cutting down to two doors will show that it's just not enough and we have to get vestibules. But without knowing those things, I'll have a difficult time.
So one of the things we've added, and that we could have put in the enhancement slide, is we're assigning adults to any doors now that kids are entering in as a result of a situation that we had that was publicized in the paper. You know, we had a community member that was very verbally aggressive with a student, which really caused Washington to change their drop-off procedures last year. They brought all the kids in the building instead of having them outside waiting in line or playing. When they arrive, if it's after 8:35, we have an established time. Another community training conversation opportunity, because some parents will drop the kids off prior to when they know that we'll have supervisors on premises and they let them play alone, or sometimes they'll bring them there and supervise them while they play on school grounds prior to that arrival. So those are all conversations that we're starting to have. Principals understand that we do want to reduce the number of entrance and exit points, more so entrance than exit, because if kids are leaving the building, we're less concerned. We're still concerned for the overall security of even just the resources within the building. We don't want people to have access to even an empty facility. But it is something that we're talking quite a bit about, and our goal is any doors that kids can enter or exit through, we want to have adult supervisors. We're not going to get rid of our fifth grade patrols, but we want our fifth grade patrols to have adults there to help them make sure people enter and exit safely. So that is all part of a conversation that we're currently having.
How are the two doors working at Washington?
I think they're working well, but I will say that there are some staff members that are disappointed that the kindergartners can't exit out during their exit through their classroom doors, because that's been a longstanding tradition, because there's doors all over the place in Washington. There are a lot of doors at Washington School. So it's like any change. It's painful, it's slow, but we know it's the right thing to do. We're looking to our knowledge base here to inform us, and if they're telling us it's a better procedure to have kids exit through fewer doors, that's what we're building towards, and we're rolling with the growing pains.
One thought, just being a Washington parent and going through there, think about, I'm not saying you have to do it or would say you should do it, but think about whether or not it's a good idea to maybe incorporate the PTOs and the PTAs in the conversations about where, what doors and what to do, only because I do know, I've just heard as a school board member, concerns about when we first were letting them in early, the way it was done in the procedures. I know the parents were a little concerned about, wait, why would we do it that way? I think maybe they could give just a little guidance or finesse things ever so slightly to make it a little more palatable to the community. So you might want to include them in that conversation, at least the presidents, and say, what do you think about this? So they can go to their members and say, you know, yeah, this is a great idea, or gee, if it wasn't this door, that door, this is why for the community as a whole it's better, or something. You never thought about walking your kid around to here and here's a pain in the butt, you know?
I think some of the other feedback that we've heard, though, positive note from Washington, is that the parents are very thankful. If you have multiple kids in that building, you're not trying to race around very congested streets where there's hundreds of people picking up their kids within a 5 to 6 minute window, and you've got to stop your car, load a kid, go to the next door, load a kid, go around.
Oh no, good and bad,
heard,
no doubt.
Different sides. Different sides.
Yeah.
So for every negative, there's a positive. But your point is well taken, and we have the PTAs and O's with us tomorrow.
So yes, you might want to just talk about bringing them on board, because I think it could just help you. And sure. If nothing else, you get advocates of what you're doing that can speak to the community for you.
Mm-hmm. I'll add that to the agenda.
Sort of good champions.
So is limiting the doors something that would happen simultaneous with a different security plan, or is it something that we're thinking of doing maybe by next semester?
It's built in. We have a big grid. You guys have seen the grid in terms of how many entry points they have, how many staff, what would be their principles in a perfect world scenario. You've seen the document that we've put together, so we're still processing through that.
There's been a lot of conversation around your concern, and I think it's just a matter of working out the details about what the best options are. They're different for every building, so we've got to be careful about instituting something to find out it doesn't work. So I think, you know, over time, the district will arrive at the proper number of doors, the proper exiting and entrance procedures. But we have to be careful about just instituting that without a lot of thought put into traffic control and other safety issues that might exhibit themselves if we go a certain route and haven't predicted how that's going to affect traffic in the area. There's a bunch of considerations, but we've talked about that.
You and Mark have done traffic. They've spent some time watching our pickup and drop-off procedures last year, and then now that we're kind of underway and you've got everybody semi-trained in terms of the procedures at each of the schools, you and Mark will both be coming back out.
Absolutely, and I've had conversations.
It just so happened that Washington got the two at the same time because the vestibule was coming. One is not tied to the other.
No.
Right.
Okay.
Okay, any other questions by the board? Not seeing any. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Have a good night.
Our second topic for our committee of the whole is budgetary review. Luann.
Thank you.
Do we have, just out of curiosity, parliamentary review, do we have to go into an open meeting or vote on anything, or are we cool just going from a cow into a, because isn't this a special board meeting?
We'll take a vote.
To go just to be careful, I just wanted to make sure that we, I don't know, do whatever we need to do.
Taking a vote can't hurt, so.
Yeah, so I'll move that we close the cow and.
No, we're still
in the cow.
We still have to do the
budget. Oh, I'm sorry. I thought this was part of the regular meeting. My apologies.
So prior to the board adopting the budget, I'm bringing to the board some changes we saw in our tentative budget from the last draft. So in terms of revenue, we're up about $470,000, and I've outlined where we're seeing that increase. We did receive our final numbers for our state and federal grants, so that has all been updated, and we received the information from Illinois Department of Revenue on the CPPRT as far as how they're going to recoup the overpayment. They're going to do it over multiple years, so we've adjusted our numbers to reflect what we're actually planning on receiving. And then we also have a kind of flow through revenue and expenditure, which is paying off the copier leases. So we do have an offsetting expenditure against that revenue. In terms of our salaries, we saw a decrease from the last draft, and that is due to us not needing to hire as many staff. We had 6 staff members allocated in there, and we did not need to hire that many, and Joel will be discussing that during the staffing report. In the benefits, this year we moved our benefit enrollment to August from May, and there is an increase in our benefits. It's not as much as $920,000, so we are re-looking at that to see, because when Brian did the annualizing of it, sometimes we have to pay more for people like the first month. And so he's going back and looking at our major functions so we can tie that number down better.
How does the benefits work in terms of when the, I guess, what the time period is? I know you have enrollment at a certain time, but is that on a calendar year basis?
No, it runs from September to August.
Okay, thank you.
And by having our open enrollment in August, it's very difficult for us to, it was very difficult to budget right now.
Can you tell us what that word benefits means? Is
sure.
that just health?
No, it's health, dental, life insurance. It's also TRS. It's payments for retiree health insurance. So it's anything that you would consider a benefit.
So assuming that all of our staff already take part in the benefits that we offer, unless there is, they're not, and we have an influx of people, I would imagine that the numbers would remain constant absent any premium increases from the vendors, right?
Right. We did see a 5.3% increase on our PPO 350 last year, which is the plan that's accessed the most.
Okay.
Now, that plan will sunset this year and move into the NIHIP 350, which changes, you know, quite a few things in the plan.
But that number doesn't reflect 5%.
No, it's a little over 6% increase right now. And so Brian this week is looking at the different major functions to just kind of test his numbers and see, you know, because I said this is like over 6% increase, which we would not be seeing.
And if the open enrollment is closed, do we now have hard and fast numbers to make your calculations more accurate?
Right. So now he can look at it and get more accurate numbers.
Now and the next meeting.
Okay, so we'll see all that finalized on the 26th.
Yes, correct. And then the other objects part of that is related to the leases, the in and out, and then Jane made some moves in some of her grants, so increasing and decreasing other objects. So I think we're almost finalized with those now. So if there's any changes, we'll put them in before the final budget's adopted.
Hey, Luann, going back to the salaries, I know you had a sort of a footnote here that the increase is being negotiated and are included in this draft. So what is there already some sort of salary increase that was built into the budget?
Yes.
I just wanted to
make sure we understand. 3% increase.
Okay.
So it was kind of a 3% across the board. So anyone that's received their salary for this year, that is in there. But we didn't put in anything as far as what we've been negotiating in there yet, so it's still a 3%.
So our budget does have a salary increase already factored.
Yes,
into it.
Yes, okay. It does have that.
Historically, it's been like the placeholder until we know exactly what the percentage is going to be, just for budgeting purposes.
Right.
Correct. Then in our other funds, there was no remarkable changes except in the capital projects fund. I added in the Lincoln Window Project, which you guys approved since the last draft, and then the Carpenter North Gym roof deck replacement and re-roofing, which you guys are scheduled to review and approve tonight. So our next steps are there'll be a public hearing on Monday, September 26th at 6:45 in advance of our regular meeting. And at that time, you'll have an update of the five-year financial projections with our unaudited actuals and then our 2016-17 budget that we're bringing for approval.
Are there any questions by the board for Luann regarding this tentative budget? I'm not seeing any. I'll go to the audience. Are there any questions on the tentative budget as been presented tonight? And if not, we certainly will have the final presentation of the budget on the 26th. And I will, again, entertain comments and questions or comments by the public, because that will be a... the public.
That's the time. What's the hearing?
The public hearing.
Legal hearing.
The public hearing for the budget to be passed that night. Okay. Any comments? Further final comments by the board for the committee of the whole? And not seeing any, do I have a motion to close the committee of the whole?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? None. We now move into our special meeting. And Vicki, would you take the roll, please?
Mark Eggeman.
Here.
Bob Johnson.
Here.
Vicki Lee is here. Tony Borelli.
Here.
Scott Zimmerman.
Here.
Dathan Paterno.
Here.
And Tom Sotos.
Here.
Okay. We have a few items. Of course, we have public comments, as this is a special meeting conducted just like any regular meeting. So I go to the audience, and if there's anybody who would like to come to the podium and provide a comment for us, that's fine, please.
It should be on. Hold that button down a little bit.
Is it on?
Sounds like it. Yeah.
Hello.
You have to say, can you hear me now?
Can you hear me now? Good evening. My name is Jane Reardon. I'm a Park Ridge parent, and I'm also the executive director of the Illinois Supreme Court Commission on Professionalism. I have a couple of comments tonight, and first I want to thank the board for their service. I know that you put in long hours, and you are dedicated to what you do. I also, as many of you know, have had four children go through District 64, and they were well prepared for high school, and my comments are not directed to the quality of the teachers or the education. I'm coming to you to share my perspective in my day job. To promote professionalism, I travel the state, I travel the nation, and I say, if we are going to have more professionalism in our legal and judicial systems, and you are part of that as our democratically elected folks here, we need to have greater transparency. We need to have people part of the process. If we don't have people part of the process, as we've seen in Ferguson and in Chicago, we have people who feel shut out and they are not trusting of their elected officials. We don't want that. I'm sure you don't want that. I would like you to reconsider your position that you will not disclose the tentative draft agreements with the teachers and the teachers' assistants. As I spent quite a bit of time on the District 64 website, I was trying to find out, what are we taxpayers going to be obligated to pay for this? And there's a multi-page document here, and I understand from listening to the proceedings that this is all very tentative, but as I leafed through it category by category, near as I can tell, we're talking about at least $50 million a year over 4 years. I don't know. I'll be honest. I think these documents are a little bit difficult for the average person to understand, and I'd ask you to look at making it a little bit more transparent. Nonetheless, it's a large number, $200 million perhaps over 4 years, that the taxpayers are on the are going to be on the hook for. We'd like to see what we are going to be obligated to pay. Now, I understand, and there's some FOIA requests that were on the table out there. And of course, I also know that those requests were denied. We all know that under the Freedom of Information Act, you aren't obligated to release tentative agreements. I ask you, as your public servants to the taxpayer, that you, as Mr. Borelli was quoted in the paper, use your discretion. You are allowed to release the tentative agreements. Please, do so. Let the taxpayers and the citizens who elected you and who are paying the teachers see what is coming down the pike. I'm hoping that we don't have a final education budget on the 26th, but again, in the interest of transparency, release it in advance so we can be part of the process and aren't shut out. Thank you very much.
Anthony, I know this is not a question answer thing, but I'd like to ask one question.
Okay.
When you ask us to release it, are you asking us to release it so that you and the public would have their opportunity to give their opinion on the contract? Or is it so that you can just have it viewed prior to us making our vote or voting on it?
You are our elected representative. Would you not seek to elicit the opinions of those who elected you? I would think you would want to know that. Do you not?
I asked a mere question. I mean,
yeah.
You also elected us to make these decisions for you, to now come back and ask if the decisions we made are okay with you. Do we put it out there and have 48,000 or how many people live in Park Ridge? 35,000 people come to us and tell us their opinion, as we might have 35,000 differing opinions as to how this contract should look. I'm sure you looked at the contract and the length of it. There's a lot of moving parts on this contract, and it's not something that that an average citizen looking at it over a week or two is going to be able to identify instantaneously or even over a period of time on whether they are approving it or disapproving it. So the mere question I'm asking is, are you asking us to publicize it, requesting your approval of it, the community's approval of it, or are you requesting us to add to display it so that you know what it looks like prior to us going to vote for it?
Either one would be an improvement over what I understand the process may be. I think it highly likely that a very lengthy contract would not give you 35,000 opinions, but it would really do a lot for transparency. Yes, you might get some people saying, you're my elected representative, what about this, what about that? You're going to get that after the fact.
So if I get 6 or 10 or 50 people that come in and say, I absolutely don't like it, am I then, as an elected official, am I then to take that those 50 people and take their opinions and allow that to change the way I felt about the contract prior to them reviewing it? For example, I may feel that the contract is exactly the way I think it should be. I was elected, I was in these negotiations, I was a part of them, and this is how I feel this contract should be. And then 10 people come to the podium and say, I don't like this, 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 and this, and we elected you, and you just hurt us, so now do something about it, Mr. Sotos. Am I then to change the way I felt about it because of those 10 people, or do I have to wait for 100 people, or do I have to wait for 1,000 people? Where is the number that I have to wait to hear from the public to change my mind, the mind that was elected by the individuals to make this decision for them in the first place? Where do I make that cutoff? I'm asking this question because I've struggled with this difficult question. I would love to publish it. I am for publishing it.
Great.
However, there's reasons for not publishing it, and then there's this reason. If we do publish it, or if I can get the board to agree to publish it, are we publishing it just so the public can see it? What does that do for transparency if I say to the public, here, you know what, we agreed to publish it, but don't bother talking to us about it because we're not going to change our minds, whatever minds each individual board member has already come up with, because there was a lot of negotiation on this contract to get it to even be ratified by the PREA, if and when they ratify it.
Well,
I don't want to publicize it and then say to the public, oh, I'm sorry, yeah, we published it, but we didn't really expect you to respond.
I'm going to have to jump in here. So this is not the forum to have this philosophical debate. It perhaps someday should come out, but this is a comment. We've heard your comment, Tom. You've asked your question. I hope that your question's been answered.
I didn't answer it at all.
Right. So I think you should have an opportunity, at least a minute or two.
All right,
no.
Please.
My response would be, you are an elected official, whether you disclose or listen to the citizens or not. I don't think you can put a number on it because X number of people came up, you're obligated to change your mind. You're not obligated to change your mind. I believe, as a citizen, you're obligated to have an open mind, though. You're obligated to listen. Doesn't mean you have to change your mind. You need to use your best judgment. But I think you all are obligated to listen to the citizens who elected you. That would be my answer.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you.
Joan Sandrick. Keeping in mind that there are lies, damn lies, and statistics, I'm sure you've all seen Chicago Magazine's latest issue of the best schools. And in suburban Cook County, there were 20 selected. We didn't make the list, oh well. What I found interesting, however, was the fact that according to the Illinois State Board of Education website and the District 64 website, the instructional cost per pupil in District 64 for 2013-14 was $9,824. Of the 20 schools that Chicago Magazine deemed the best, 15 of them had a lower instructional cost per student. Some of them, not so much, some of them in the $3,000 range. I guess my question is, what are they doing that we aren't? That's a big difference. And along with that, Appendix 3 for tonight's agenda, our business manager or business official states at the bottom of the page that this is regarding residency. Our hope is that all taxpaying residents of Park Ridge Niles realize that non-residents are costing their school district approximately $14,000 per student to educate annually. And yet again, according to the district website, for fiscal year 2014-15, that number is $15,613. That's a big difference. Also, in the sample letter that was the attachment one to Appendix 3, the letter that is sent to the cheaters, states that the cost is based on annual tuition of $13,832. That's a very old number. And accordingly, the per diem, I'm sure, is incorrect as well. So I guess my hope is that that'll be updated, or that there is some way to make sure that if we're sending out letters that we have...
That's only a sample letter we gave the board.
I understand, but unfortunately, things have a way of slipping through the cracks sometimes. And I'm not saying you would, I'm just saying it's an old number from several years ago. Also, like Ms. Reardon, I too would like to know what the terms of the contract are. It seems to me that if the PREA has disseminated the information to their constituency, there's not a reason around that you can't disseminate that same information to us. It just does not seem right that we're kept in the dark, and yet you want us to come to a budget meeting and we're not going to know. So I would encourage you to disseminate that information. I know, based on President Borelli's comments in the Herald Advocate, that there's some question in his mind as to whether we can comprehend all of this and the backstory. I can assure you that my reading comprehension has always been quite good, and while it may have diminished with age, it's still pretty damn good. So I would certainly like an opportunity to review, if not the whole contract, at least the high points. Thank you.
Is there anybody else in the audience? Not seeing any. I was going to make a few comments. I promised, as we started tonight, I was going to add a new section to the president's message. And generally, the president's message includes general updates and recanting of meeting times and dates. Tonight, I introduce a new entity included in the president's message. I will call this the Citizen's Corner. As a form of outreach and public education, I will relay, respond, and provide answers to citizen inquiries and concerns presented or communicated to the board since our last meeting. Each meeting, we have a public comments section which serves solely for individual comments to the board without an expectation of a response. As our public comments section required by the Open Meetings Act, frankly, is insufficient to answer public concerns, I fear that folks may take it that the board is not listening to the public as there is no feedback. It's my desire and hope that this forum provides information, answers, and updates to questions and concerns of the public on District 64 activity. I start by clarifying a quote of mine in a recent newspaper article. My quote referenced the PREA tentative contract and the current board practice of withholding its release to the public until after board ratification. The ongoing negotiated contract is currently tentative as a working document, not in its final form. It is subject to revisions until finalized and agreed upon. In its current state, it is not yet ready for public viewing. That being said, this is a document that I, as a member of the Board Negotiation Committee, have spent the past 10 months working on. I've invested, as many members of the negotiations have, well over 150 hours in preparation so as to be knowledgeable in all its facets. It is a 90-page legal document describing all activity of members of the district and is quite complex as anyone could and should well imagine. Not all sections of the contract are equal in terms of important to each side. A lot of back and forth goes on to get resolution on specific issues for each side. Certainly anyone with a background and knowledge of these issues can plod through the contract. Without knowing the specifics of the areas of importance to the respective sides and the interrelationship of those areas with other areas of the contract, which can be impacted, could lead to misunderstanding. Similarly, without the proper background and understanding of all the issues, centering on one small section of one article of this 90-page document, essentially taking it out of context, would also confuse the overall focus of the document. However, once finalized, it has been board practice that the contract be ultimately available to the public. Furthermore, I believe it is important that salient sections are explained so that the public is aware of content and changes made. Referencing our last meeting, the board had two individuals speak in our public comments section. The first speaker noted as to how the president could make a motion regarding the Roberts Rules of Order. A simple review of Board Policy 2:110 clearly explains that the sitting president can make a motion and second a motion and function and participate as any other board member. He also mentioned that his property tax has doubled in the last 12 years and asked for fiscal restraint by the board on behalf of the taxpayers. As a Park Ridge taxpayer, I share those concerns. As this issue comes up each year at this time, it would be a good time to review the PTEL revenue constraints that the district works under. The property tax extension limitation law was originally enacted to limit property tax increases in non-home rule taxing districts. Taken from an Illinois Department of Revenue published statement, the PTEL allows a taxing district to receive a limited inflationary increase in tax extensions on existing property, plus an additional amount for new construction. This limit slows the growth of revenues to taxing districts when property values and assessments are increasing faster than the rate of inflation. PTEL was finally enacted in Cook County in 1994. After it had been utilized in other counties in the state of Illinois. Cook County adopted the PTEL instrument and the primary tax rate, which was established by the state of Illinois. The rate of increase has been limited to the lesser of either 5% or the rate of CPI from the preceding year. Since CPI has not gone over 5% since 1994, tax increase has been limited to the CPI. CPI is the rate of inflation. It costs more each year to buy the same goods and services. Simply, the value of money decreases. It takes more money each year to buy the same good and services than the year before. When increasing by the CPI, the amount of money increases, but the value of money remains the same. This means that though the amount of taxes increase, the cost of goods and services that amount could buy in 1994 is the same as in 2016. Essentially, the value of the amount from 1994 is the same as the value of 2016. The district, while having more dollars in tax receipts, cannot spend or buy any more than 1994. Despite having district property tax revenue controlled or limited to the increase of CPI, same value, more dollars, the district has done more with less. An example of cost management would be the tax referendum of 2007, expected to be exhausted within 10 years and requiring another capital referendum in 2017, we find today that our district is still operating in the black. We have not yet started deficit spending fully expected long before now. This and past boards have worked with the administration so that rather than expecting a new referendum in 2017, the timeline has been extended out to 2020 at the earliest. We have done this not through increased taxes, but control of spending to free up funds. I would consider this to be an obvious example of fiscal restraint. Our second speaker from last meeting mentioned that he felt that salary increases to the administration were not warranted as there is no academic increase to validate those increases. He stated that it's widely known in the community that test scores have not gone up. To that point, I direct everyone to the report provided by Assistant Superintendent Dr. Lori Lopez, given on August 8, 2016. We're all aware of the PARC testing and the constant revisions to it. Revisions unfortunately prevent evaluation on a longitudinal basis. At the high school level, the PARC has been discontinued, giving pause for concern over its continued use at the elementary level. The board is centered, among other things, on using the MAP test as a reliable method to evaluate our students. The measure of academic progress test, known as MAP, is a real-time age-specific test that is equal interval, allowing for year-to-year comparisons in two areas, current knowledge as well as continual academic growth. These entities are also known as status and growth, respectively. Furthermore, any status score above the 93rd percentile is termed at a competitive level, and evaluating the growth scores, an average above 50 is considered above average, and above 60 on the growth portion is considered exceptional. A review of the spring district MAP scores shows overall academic improvement. Status district scores in reading increased from 91 to 93, which is considered the competitive level, while in math they increased from 86 to 88. Not quite competitive, but certainly climbing. District 64 growth status in reading increased from 39 to 55, or above average, and in math the increase was from 66 to 68, and the level is labeled as exceptional. Over 1 year ago, the board also asked administration to obtain an analysis of like communities who are expected to perform and are performing at a high level so they can have a better analysis of our scores when compared to similar districts and not just state or national averages. Administration approached NWEA, who administered the testing. They created a national sample of like districts, national virtual comparison group, similar in size and financial resources with which to compare district achievements. An analysis of this data shows that in the reading growth area, we are staying consistent with other high-performing districts, which are above average, while in the growth math area, we are increasing and outperforming the virtual comparison groups. On a year-to-year basis, this is further evidence of increasing academic performance in the district. With these remarks, I had hoped to further inform the public on data already presented, but perhaps missed by newspapers and random review of the district website. As always, more information can be found at the district website, and I encourage any and all to review the posted information at any time the board encourages informed commentary with which we can all improve the district.
If I may, and I'm always willing to have appointments with folks or to engage in email exchanges, so you always email me with questions. I spent an hour and a half with a community member last week in my office, so if you want information, email or schedule an appointment with my admin. I'm happy to make myself available as well.
So moving along the agenda, the next item is the enrollment and staffing report. Joel. You have a question. You'll need to come up here.
My name is Mike Reardon. I was the second speaker that you referred to last at the last meeting. Thank you for the information you provided. I would request, though, that if you're going to quote me, you get the quote accurate. I don't believe I said that the staff does not deserve raises. I believe I said, and I'd like you to check the video and make sure that I'm correct on this. I believe I said, none of you asked what is the measurable increase in student performance for these raises. I did not make the comment that the staff did not deserve them. And I would request that if you are going to be rebutting every citizen's comments later, self-serving as it may be, that you at least get their quotes correct. Thank you.
Next item is the enrollment and staffing report. Joel.
Okay. Good evening. It's that time of year when the district reports our six-day enrollment to the state of a state board. So we are beginning a process of tying together the enrollment and staffing report together at this time of year because the two are directly related, and it only makes sense that when we talk about the enrollment at the beginning of the school that we also review and discuss where our staffing has landed as we start for the 2016-17 school year. So we're going to begin with our enrollment. So our six-day enrollment for the 16-17 school year as of August 24, 2016 was 4,429 students, which was up 57 students from last year's six-day enrollment, or up 49 students from the end of the previous school year. So what we're seeing is, obviously, is a trend of increased enrollment of close to 60 students. So we're happy about that. There is a difference if we look at our CASARTA report, where the district had Dr. CASARTA update in 2013 enrollment projections for the district using Series B of the CASARTA report. Dr. CASARTA projected the enrollment to be 4,314, so he was off by exactly 115 students. So right now we are seeing that the growth that we are currently experiencing is not what was predicted versus the CASARTA report, and it's not what was predicted, quite honestly, probably on our last staffing.
Joel, can I just ask a question?
Sure.
CASARTA provided three levels of enrollment. Uh-huh. It was the A, B, and C levels.
Right.
Are we currently on a trajectory with his highest levels?
And I'd have to go back and pull that up for you, Dr. Borelli, if you give me, or give me a little bit of time to get back to you on that. I don't have that information. I do have his report, but I don't have it real handy. So can I, without wasting too much time,
sure.
Can I come back on that?
Yeah.
Because I do know that the C is the maximum, so I'd have to look and see where we're at compared to that. I know traditionally we have used B as the standard, so I stuck with B as it's the report that we have used with the board in the past.
Right.
But it's a good question.
I know, Tony, looking at our our financial report from last year shows that actually in 2018 we were forecasting about 4,455 students, so this is kind of, I guess, close to getting closer to that number, perhaps.
Was that using CASARTA, or was that using the cohort?
I think the cohort was just being started this year, wasn't it, Luann? So
that would be CASARTA. That still begs the question, is it the B or C level?
I'm in the deck.
And I'm getting there, but if you give me just a second, I'm still at each
school. I guess just for numbers in 2015, it shows we had 4,372, so this... this would be at least, 50 more than 2015.
So, and what would that mean if our projections by CASARTA had three levels and we had a higher assumption, right? How would that affect our overall planning for staffing then?
Well, I think, and I'm looking at CASARTA, first of all, the CASARTA C projection for the 16-17 year, which is the max, is 4,642. So he's well over where we currently say if you go with the max projection. The C is the B, which we talked about before, is the one that we've consistently used, which is the 4,381. And then the A, which is the ultra-conservative projection, which is 4,131. So we're kind of in between the B and the C. I guess I would say at the moment, I'm not sure what the numbers are saying. I've been staring at them for a while trying to figure out what they're trying to tell us. And what I see by that is, quite honestly, I'm a little perplexed by them. And what I'm going to talk about, and I guess I could speak about it here, is, what we're seeing, and I know as Luann has talked about with the cohort method of projecting moving forward, we'll really analyze and look at this. I think we projected or foresaw that typically kindergarten is the hardest to guess at because we're just simply taking 1 year's numbers and rolling them over. That's the method we were doing in the past. Yeah,
we're using live birth data.
No, for the last thing, what we did, we'd take the current and we would just roll them into the next. But regardless, it's the most volatile number we have is kindergarten. We see this again. That's where we had the most movement. But yet we had first grade where we would typically see a lot of movement. We did see it some places, but at other buildings such as Roosevelt, where we have typically seen quite a bit of movement in our kindergarten and first grade, we saw very little movement. We're two kids away at first grade at Roosevelt, basically for a significant amount of time. Yet Washington is going up, and we have seen that for a while. Field has gone up just a little bit, but is kind of staying steady. We've been keeping an eye on Field because of some of the new construction with those townhomes that have been
popping up to look and see what impact that may have. So far, while it has, you know, 7 kids, I would not say is a dramatic change from one year to the next, but we're keeping an eye on that. I'd say Washington and Roosevelt are the two biggest kind of eye openers. Washington going up significantly, continues, has been on a trend. At the fact, same point, Roosevelt going down, which is typically been a building that the enrollment, we lost kids over the summer. We don't typically do that for Roosevelt. So that's why I said, you know, the I don't know what it's telling us in the moment other than we've gained kids and we're trying to kind of look at and trying to figure out the why. I don't have a pattern as of yet. It's kind of an answer of a whole lot of nothing. Sorry about that.
No, it's a number that is all over the board every year. And, you know, using, just so people are aware, we use this number for staffing and budgetary purposes, but we also use it for space purposes.
Mm-hmm.
The buildings have a limited space to them, and you know, we have to know what the max capacity would be.
Yeah. So I think on that component, what we're continue to be concerned about is Field in Washington. You know, Field has been pretty much at the close to max. They continue to stay at that level. Luckily, they have not gone to the point where I think that Katie and Amanda over there at Field were really feel like they're more under the gun than they currently have been in the last couple of years. Washington, I think, you know, remains a concern for us for space. Adding the enrollment, increasing at Washington, there's limited space for there, and I know the fear that Mrs. Daly had over the summer was, if a couple of these bubbles were to pop, where are we going to put all these kids and how many things are going to end up being on a carton? You can have so many things on a, you can only have so many classes on stages and other things that we do believe, or we are concerned about the space at those buildings. And what I would say that the report is telling us is that Field continues to be at watch. We're close to a couple classrooms away from being a real problem, and I'd say Washington, if it continues on the trend, we are going to have some space issues without a doubt. And I don't know if Lou Ann or Lori want to add on to that at all.
Part of what we're going to talk about certainly is part of our facility count in October. Yep. In the plan through a boundary study.
Yeah.
And
what we're seeing with the Washington enrollment is it's starting to have an impact on Lincoln, where the enrollment at Lincoln has been going in the opposite direction versus Emerson. It's starting to now go back up, primarily because of the impact, I believe, of Washington rolling over into Lincoln, which is a good thing. We like to have those buildings as close in size as possible. It helps for just continuity of programming often. And we'll obviously be looking into this in greater detail and then discussing this as we come back the enrollment with the Board of Education in the February, typically, when we start to look at our projected enrollments and the impact of that in the 17-18 year. And I know we'll sit down at some point here as we go into fall, and Lou Ann and I will start to really look at this and the impact of what it's telling us for the cohort.
So on the cohort survival, Brian and I didn't have a lot of time to analyze it, but we actually came in, and it's not reflected here, fairly close with our numbers, except for the Field kindergarten, realizing that we don't have live birth data from Niles. So we can't take their entire live birth data. So we just, next year, we'll probably adjust that. But typically when I look at it, and obviously when we put it into the cohort model, we'll see. But when I see class sizes of 99 going out at fifth grade and class sizes of 73 at kindergarten, right, then I'm looking at decreases. You know, I see some large classes at Roosevelt School, 131 at second grade, yet I only see 96 at kindergarten. So you start to see, you know, places where it's, you know, we could potentially see drops, but then when we put in the cohort, it will tell us if typically at that grade we see over a 100%, you know, change in that. So we'll be able to run that and look at it.
The only thing I would say is we usually see an increase in first grade because some people go somewhere else for full day kindergarten.
Right, and we have that figured in. So the that is figured in.
So the next part of the report is to talk about the staffing. And I'm going to refer back just for a moment to the report that I gave to the board in June of this year, where we talked about how we do the staffing and the class size guidelines and the impact that has on staffing. In the report that we gave the class size guidelines of 22 at kindergarten, first and second 24, third and fourth 26, and fifth through eight at 28. So if you recall, when we exceed those class size guidelines at a grade level at a school by one student over the summer, we add another section and typically hire a teacher. What we are showing this year is, and this is something that is the opposite of what we could have experienced in the past, is our enrollment has gone up, but our staffing went down slightly. So this previous year, at the end of the year, our staffing numbers were 394.87 FTE, or full-time equivalent teachers. We started the year with 394.11 full-time equivalent teachers, or a decrease of 0.76 FTE. And again, just to explain why the enrollment went up and the staffing went down, it's often where the students come at. We've had years in the past where the enrollment has gone down and the staffing has gone up, which, again, we've sat and said the exact same thing to the Board of Education, that the kids came at the wrong spots, meaning, you know, if you had a grade level that two kids pushed it over, where if they would have came at another building, it would have taken 10 or 12 kids to push it over. So this year we just happened to have it where the new enrollment often did not, or came at those class sizes that had a buffer, so to speak. So we were able to add students, and in some places the enrollment increased without having to add staff, roughly being the same enrollment or the same staffing needs as we had for the previous year. Now I will just say two things on that. First one is to kind of give you an idea of how close this is. We had at fifth grade at Roosevelt, for example, we had lost students over the summer and dropped a section and end up having to reassign a teacher to an open section. It could easily go the opposite way. We pick up two kids, twins move, don't move out, we get one more kid, you add an FTE. We had a couple sections through that at some of our buildings where the enrollment increased over the class size guidelines after school started. Had those come or those students enrolled prior to the start of the year, this FTE may have looked very different because we may have made a different decision where we would have added teachers. So while we are down slightly in staffing for this year, I just want to put that out there that when students enroll plays a big factor on that, and I know that some of the principals really were out there trying to get these parents we knew, but they wouldn't enroll and they didn't come until after the school started. And that really had an impact on us coming under the FTE compared to last year. Does that make sense to everybody?
Mm-hmm. Any questions of Joel regarding the staffing? Thanks, Joel. Appreciate it. Next item will be the, I'm sure it'll come back. This never ends. And frankly, I'm always crazed when I see enrollment going down and staffing going up. Mm-hmm. This is a wonderful point counterpoint to that, and it kind of brings it all home. Yeah. Next item is the approval of Carpenter School Roof Project. Luann.
So Terry's in the audience. If you have any questions, do you want to come up here, Terry? So as we had discussed with the board at the August 8th meeting, when our contractor went to remove the roof at Carpenter, it was discovered that the tectum deck underneath of it had been compromised and needed to be replaced. So at that time, the board directed us to go back out to bid, which we did. We received four bids. And the lowest responsible bidder was National Roofing Corporation with a bid of $330,000. Nicholson Associates did vet out the top two bidders, and National Roofing's bid was good at $330,000. We're also looking at, a minimum of a $42,000 credit back from Metalmaster Roofing for their portion of the Carpenter roof that they did not do this summer. So I don't know if you want to add anything to that, Terry, about the roof. Well, we're going to move forward with the metal roof.
Yeah, there was an addendum or an alternate for the replacing it with Tectum, which is what was there, and that was an add in all four cases.
What's Tectum?
Actually, to party jump on board with Bob, I have a question here. What's the difference between the Tectum and the metal roofs? I think this was described before, but I don't, yeah, maybe you can help us out here.
All right, I'll see if I can describe this.
We're not looking for a super technical, I guess. Just looking at the, so you got this bid of $330,000, and then the alternate says, which I'm guessing would be an additional cost.
Yes,
of $75,000 for Tectum. So I just trying to understand, you know, what that is. And just to be clear, I guess, if, you know, would we be voting for, you know, approving somebody at $330,000? Plus 75?
No, it's no. Just 330.
No, we wouldn't be using the Tectum. The Tectum was an additional cost above and beyond. The metal deck that was bid is actually a better product. It's more secure. It has a better insulating qualities. We won't have the problem that we had with the Tectum, that you start to get the sagging through the years. Part of the problem with the Tectum decking is it comes in 8 and 12 foot lengths, and our span is 8 foot 6 or 8 foot 8, so we would have to buy a 12 foot deck and cut and waste for almost 4 feet of it, and you would still have the problem with it sagging. Tectum is...
It looks like shredded wheat.
Yeah. Well, you're saying, I mean, I don't think you have to go farther. You're saying the Tectum's not as good a product as other one.
Well, Tectum's a good product. It's been around a long time. For our application, I don't think it's the right way to go.
Okay.
Tectum is kind of a fiberglass impregnated concrete, lightweight concrete, that's approximately 3 inches thick, 4 inches thick.
We use it a lot in acoustical applications, more so applied than a structural. It's a Tectum panel or a Tectum ceiling, but not in a structural capacity. Technologies have changed.
And these, I know we've done a bunch of roofs lately, so these, when we do these now, because I think in the past we might have had trouble tracking this, is there some sort of guarantee period then that we get for these, 10 years, 15 years, so if something fails? We've got a financial recourse at all, or is it like tires on a car, and there's sort of a gradated schedule where it falls off over time as to how much you get paid?
No, I would, and I'm not certain what the exact warranty is on it. We can find that out for you. I would think that the whole assembly has at least a 10-year warranty on the deck and everything.
And the shingles should be a 20 to 25. So
okay.
Okay. And with the metal deck, the metal deck's going to outlast any of us here.
Okay. I guess, are we storing information on these things? Like, so we've been doing all this new roofing and stuff, you know, to make it easier for, you know, someone, Luann, if you're not here in 10 years, you know, for somebody to be able to access. Because it seemed like in the past we asked some questions and there was some difficulty with people saying, I really, you know, for different products or things, like, yeah, we really don't know exactly what kind of warranty we have. And we wondered, well, are we missing out on some money here? I know a lot of our roofs were very, very old and way past any period someone might have done.
But we will have all the warranty information, and we had met today, Ron and Lori and I, just, you know, looking at 1617 in detention again. And that's one thing we'll want FGM to show the board is, remember they had initially showed you those roof maps that showed you the different colors on where we needed to replace. And so we can now show you the new ones, and they can talk about the warranty on the roofs. But I mean, the most important thing is not necessarily the warranty, is that we do the correct upkeep on the roofs,
not just
going forward, so that we can, you know, get them to at least their useful life. So, you know, that's part of Ron's responsibility, and he's very good at doing stuff like that, is making sure we do any maintenance on the roofs going forward so that they last at least to their useful life.
Is that in part what happened with the Tectum?
The Tectum just started sagging from its own weight, from years, you know, from being stretched to the limits, and actually, I don't even know how any of those hasn't caused any problems because of the way it's sitting in there.
So they shouldn't span 8 feet then?
Yeah, they pushed the limits of the length of the Tectum technology back in 94, and that, with the type of shingle that was used, was just not the right combination.
It was a residential shingle.
Mm-hmm. So, but we will have information on the, you know, warranties on the roof and when you would could expect to potentially need to replace those roofs going forward.
Yeah.
So we'll bring that back to the board.
My concern was just beyond when you and Ron are here that we'll have some sort of system for people to these different projects we do to be
right.
able to find.
Well, that was our other thinking of using a metal deck, is that the metal deck is going to stand up to anything.
Yeah, you should get 30 years out of a metal deck with no problem. Not more.
But we're going to have nice digital archives of all this work
yes.
that we don't have now.
So I'm glad you're here. Is there, first let me ask, are any board member would like to get more information, steel, Tectum, whatever, and not seeing any? I have one question. Since 2012, the board has allocated, if you include this summer's work, next summer's work, and the health, life, safety, which will be completed in the summer of 18, we will have spent approximately $41 million on our buildings and for the envelopes themselves. So what I'd like to know, if as a just for planning purposes and an understanding in toto, I'm wondering if we can get an idea of what's still going to be needed in these buildings.
That's detention.
And their costs. What's that?
That's detention.
Yeah, they already gave me my homework to show up at detention.
Because I think
we met with them late, the FGM team, Lynn, Ron, and I, late into the evening Friday, and then we were back at my table today. The cow on October 11th, we roughed out, prepared to be here for quite some time, folks. We have a lot to share. We're kind of putting together the big chunks, and that's certainly one of them. What have we spent to date? What have we spent, you know, in the last couple of years? They're working on recosting projects.
The health, life, safety.
The whole health, life, safety.
And this now is still just building envelope. We're not even talking about 21st century.
No.
We're not even talking about that.
21st century carpets.
Nothing.
Painting.
No pretty projects.
Well,
the pretty stuff
is asbestos in there?
So what
asbestos would be in there in the areas that we'd be working in.
Right, and so we have asbestos on the floors. Generally, we find it in pipe fittings. We also have it in the cellar at one of the buildings, and then in some of the roofs.
From my understanding, though, we have eliminated a fair amount of asbestos in the last 2 years.
We still have a lot of asbestos.
There's a lot of asbestos tile under the carpeting.
Yeah, I know that.
But just in case anybody's watching this on video, it's not that students are at any
No, they're in no danger.
These are things that we need to replace, that
right.
we want to replace, but there's no
No. And if there ever is, we take care of it immediately. Yes, no danger.
But there is a cost to it, and that's what's
Oh, yeah, no, I know that.
I want to know how much more.
Right.
All right, well, I guess we're looking forward to October then. Thanks. All right.
Thanks, Jerry. It's a long time to stick around, but we're glad you're working.
Any other comments on the roof project? As this is an action item, I go to the audience. If there's anybody who wants to make a comment on the roof and not seeing anybody coming forward, I'll ask the board, anybody want to make a motion?
I move that the Board of Education of Community Consolidated School District 64 Park Ridge, Niles, Illinois, approve the contract for the Carpenter Elementary School North Gym Roof Deck Replacement and Re-Roofing Project to National Roofing Corporation at a total cost of $330,000.
Is there a second?
Second.
And just to be certain, I see Nicholas and Associates has signed off on this, so they did the vetting and
yes.
we're good with this company. Okay, why don't we start with Tom? It's Carpenter.
Yes.
Aye.
Aye.
Yes.
Aye.
Aye.
Yes.
Well,
So what will happen next, because I saw Brett sitting back there waiting for you guys to vote, I have in my to-do now, it will be to set up a meeting with him, because the roofing won't start for probably about another month, and so we'll be working with him to make sure we have the safe passage of students in and out of the buildings, and you know what he's going to do with lunch and gym and everything like that.
You know, we're supposed to have this wrapped up before the snow flies.
I know.
What is the timeline?
When I talked to Lucas, he said it was 3 to 4 weeks, because they have to get the metal decking in, and then they'll get started, you know, right away. We can, and the removal is going to take, that's going to be a difficult process, correct?
So take your mic.
3 to 4 weeks for the total completion?
No, for the supplies to come in.
Oh. Yeah, they're saying 3 to 4 weeks for the metal decking to be made and arrive on site. There's two trains of thought on how they want to do the demo, whether to demo the whole deck, start Friday after school, do it Saturday, Sunday, and have it ready for Monday to start putting the new deck up, or if they want to do half of a roof at a time, demo half, put the new deck on half, and then the following weekend demo the other half and put it on there again. We have a meeting that we're going to need to sit down with Lucas and with Terry and Luann and I to set up what the plan is going to be on, once we know what the delivery is and we award the contract.
So it looks like you're not going to get started till about middle of October, right? But from what you're saying, it's a matter of days, not weeks, for demolition.
I would think, barring any bad weather, that they can probably tear it off and re-roof it in two to 3 weeks.
And how long?
2 to 3 weeks at the most.
2 to 3.
You know, have it watertight, and yeah, then put the shingling and things on after that. But they would put the decking up, put the nail base on for the ice and water shield, and get it all watertight. And then they would just be, you know, going along with the shingling, which, as long as we're watertight, at that point, it doesn't matter.
Okay. But still, conceivably, by October 30th. Huh?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Terry.
Residency update.
Okay. So, yes, we do make sure we charge the correct cost for the residency. We don't make any mistakes. Brian's involved in that calculation and gives those numbers to Peggy when she's preparing the letters to send out to the families on what the tuition is that they would potentially owe. So last year, we removed 12 students from the district. Only one of those, or actually two of the students, which was one family, had a formal residency hearing that came before the board-appointed hearing officer. And you guys might vaguely remember, we had to have a special meeting for you guys to review the findings and to vote on it. And the district did prevail in that residency hearing. On the other cases, what typically will happen is either they get the letter from me and they just disappear into the night, or they do request a meeting with Dr. Hines and myself, and we review my side of the case, and they are allowed to tell her basically their side of why they live in the district, or are saying they live in the district. And through those, we've been able to have people just choose to take their children out of the school and put them in the district where they currently live, which does save us the money of having to go through the hearing officer in the hearing. So that was something that we added last year, which was that additional step of them meeting with her and I to kind of review their case. And as you know, most people will generally screw up when they're talking So we usually, it's usually works out. I just included some of the ways that we receive information on residency issues. It's either a telephone call or written communication from someone letting us know. Our principals and building secretaries have been very good about notifying us of, you know, odd things. The student's late every day. The student's not picked up. So we look at different things. We have students that tell their teacher, or the principal, or someone else that they don't live, you know, where they're saying they live in Park Ridge. The kid will tell us, you know, I live in Chicago with my mother or something. So that's how we find it out. We also, at the time of registration, like this past summer, we had 6 families that chose to not continue the registration process after we questioned them about their residency, so they didn't even move forward with it. The other thing we're doing is we're running detailed background checks on approximately 20% of all of our parents and guardians within the district. And then when we look at red flags from our private investigator, we decide which ones to move forward with as far as investigating them. And some of the ones from last year were a result of a very small group of parents and guardians we looked at. And the check that he does, the detailed background, costs us $100 per family. So I feel like it's well worth it. So we're continuing this year and increase the amount that we're looking at. As of today, our investigator's working on 9 cases that we've deemed to require a formal investigation. One has already resulted in the finding that they do not live in the district, so I'm currently working with the parents on that. You know, we also just had wanted to remind everyone of what your board policy is in terms of, you know, the child cannot be staying here. They have to be on a permanent basis. This is not taking into any, you know, in any homeless issues that we deal with separately. They can't be staying there a few days during the week or for babysitting purposes. And so, you know, we're really hoping that, you know, any taxpayer that knows of someone having children attending school in our district would turn that information into us so we can pursue it.
You know, Luann, when I read this, 2 numbers jumped out at me, mm-hmm. number 12 and the number 20%.
Correct.
12, because 3 years ago when the board first started discussing evaluating enrollment, there was a, you know, there's some cost with this.
Correct.
And there was some members felt that we would never find enough students to justify the cost of actually doing this. And here we are at the end of the second year, so notice is out, people know we're doing this. And yet there's still 12 more that we find that are utilizing the facilities out of district.
Correct.
So that was, to me, pretty interesting. The second thing is the 20% of all parents and guardians. You know, we're doing in-depth investigations, and, you know, that's almost like they're guilty until proven innocent. So, I mean, how are we honoring their privacy and everything else? I mean, what kind of data is being utilized?
So, can you even mention that? I can't really go into detail, but I mean, we're not doing anything that someone couldn't pay a service to find out. So this is not us doing any, you know, on-site investigation of anyone. It's really looking at tax records as far as where they may pay taxes.
Public
records. So it's all public records that we are accessing the information.
And I ask this because we're videotaping.
Correct.
And people want to know, what are you looking at? And is it public information? Is it available on a Google search?
No, well, if you were to pay, it would be available, but it's all a source of public information that's out there, which is if someone says that they are living with someone here and we find that they are paying property taxes on a home in Chicago, then we have a few questions for them.
Right. So those are the kinds of things that you're looking for.
Correct.
And of the 9 students that you're currently doing a review on, do they come out of the 20% that you earmarked?
Yes, some of them did, and some of them were ones that we had at the end of the year put a flag on to look at if they came back this fall. Because when we get so far into the year, it's, you know, the attorney just says, you know, stop for the year.
Yeah. Any further questions for Luann?
Luann, do you want to mention that there are some districts that do run a check on everybody every year or every other year?
Right. So
it would be an expense, but it's so the
we had looked at if we did all the parents, it'd be like $20,000. So I didn't want to spend that much until we see what we can look at this year. But in my prior district, we ran everyone every year. And so it starts, you know, you kind of get the feel or know when they're reviewing them. And certainly our private investigator is very good at telling us, I think you should pursue this one. I mean, it's always our decision. But if he feels like, you know, it really is not, I mean, he was very honest telling us. So we're going to look and see what we get out of the group that we're running this year. And we'll be able to give you information next year.
Know, come to you to see if that's something you'd be interested in having.
Yeah, I think that'd be a great discussion to have for the board to think if that's a, you know, worthwhile expense.
Yeah, I mean, this is a very, very time-consuming process to go through. And my assistant, Peggy Morgan, I think she's turned into a little private investigator herself. And I must really commend our building secretaries. Quite a few of them have really helped us out and stepped up to the plate with these residency issues.
Are we taking any time or any resources in checking individuals who didn't re-register this year that registered last year? So we had, you know, if you go to the, so let's say you had, let's say last year, this year at, you know, Franklin, you had 10 families that didn't, that left the school. Are we looking at all to see if those 10 families just left because they moved to another state, or if they did it because the residency requirements were too vigorous?
I mean, there's a certain amount of information. So if they've changed districts and they request the records, then we know where the students, you know, if they left the state or if they're still in the state of Illinois. I'm not sure. We can certainly check with Janice, who runs Power School, and see what kind of information we can get as far as where the records were sent.
I'm just saying, because if you have a student that was registered in Park Ridge, and then all of a sudden the next year they're not registering, they're voluntarily not registering, so they're not raising any red flags to us to look at them, but then we're sending their records to Culver and Niles, or to a school in Des Plaines, or a school in Morton Grove, or a school, you know, just over the bridge in Chicago. We might want to, just for our purposes of knowing, you know,
maybe do a little
search on them and see if, so that we can truly identify how many people.
Well, we'll still be making assumptions, though.
Yeah,
for $100.
People could just move.
No, I get that.
But we can
that,
still but, we can you know. Still definitely look at that, because we have to. We basically know all that information, correct? Yes.
My secretary's going to
know. So I don't think it would cost us much to just kind of know, so that when we do get a, you know, a detail of, you know, the last 3 years, it was this many and potentially this many as well, because we have this list of students who, you know, we did a little research, and while they were enrolled with us, they owned the home that they are enrolled in the following year where we sent their school, their records. So if let's say I leave Park Ridge next year, and I enroll in Niles, I ask for my records to be requested to be sent to a school in Niles. We do a little research and realize that I owned that house in Niles while I was a resident here in Chicago. And now I'm back in that house in Niles asking for my records to be sent to the local school of that house. You know, that,
I understand what you're saying. I think it'd be nice to have. I know that there's just work involved.
Yeah, I was just wondering if we are doing it.
But I think this is all great, you know, in terms of, as we're talking about, you know, as our student population's increasing, we got buildings that are maybe, you know, under potential stress. I think it's great that we're doing this, and that, making sure that we're educating the students that, you know, we should for the community.
And we're enlisting all of our partners. So we've enlisted the bus company, too. So they actually give the bus driver specific direction and instruction, because they actually have helped, I believe it's in Oak Park, with identifying, you know, mom's always there to pick them up from the bus stop, and they live three houses away, you know, so they kind of watch for things like that, too. The one thing, too, I want to point out is that last year, through our efforts, we did identify someone that was homeless, so to me, that's kind of a good thing that we were able to, you know, help somebody that really didn't need help and didn't know how to come forward and ask for it.
Great.
Any other questions? And if not, next item is on page 13, consent agenda. Any additions, deletions, alterations, modifications? I can't think of any other adjectives. Anybody? How about a motion?
I move that the Board of Education of Community Consolidated School District 64, Park Ridge Niles, Illinois, approve the consent agenda of September 12, 2016, which includes the personnel report, approval of financial update for the period ending July 31st, 2016, approval of intergovernmental agreement between the governing board of the Niles Township District for Special Education 807 and Park Ridge Consolidated Community School District 64 for the provision of certain special education services, and resolution number 1170, recommending the board adopt a copy fee schedule for FOIA requests.
Is there a second?
Second.
Prior to taking a vote, I just want to ask one question. Why are we keeping the copy fees the same? I mean, paper's going up and the ink is going up. And
with our FOIAs?
Yeah.
I mean, our paper cost hasn't really gone up, and we really don't have that many. Most of them are electronic anymore, the FOIAs.
Oh, it is?
Yeah, we don't, I can't even think of the last time I had to have one mailed.
Would there be a situation where if we were to send it out electronically that we would have to charge them for scanning it, or do we pretty much scan anything anyway?
Yeah, I don't know that we could charge them because the...
Well, no, according to the actual policy that we're voting on today, we could charge them a fee. So the fee does not pertain to electronically transmitted documents unless
the electronically transmitted document
needs to be scanned in to be sent to that, you know, person requesting the FOIA, at which time we can assess the fee and then take into consideration whether we want to reduce the fee or waive the fee altogether.
Right.
So I guess my question is instead of writing all that, we can say if we have to do it, it's 5 cents.
Yeah. After the first 50 pages.
I don't think we have that many, Bernadette, that are over like a 50-page FOIA that I can remember.
We have some.
Some, but not
they're
many.
They're unduly burdensome sometimes, so then we have them narrow.
But do we, my question is, do we pretty much scan everything that we do anyway? So is it already, everything we do already in electronic form?
A lot of times it's in electronic form, or else we're able to just refer them to the website because they're asking for information.
We're not required to produce anything that we don't already have via FOIA. So there's, you know, every request is unique, and we've got to see what do we have available, what's electronic, what do we have in paper form, and so on. So each one is really looked at it on its own merit request. So.
All right, so we need to take a vote. So how about Mark?
Yes.
Aye.
Aye.
Yeah.
Aye.
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 Okay. Dr. Hines, other discussion items of information?
Yes, just a few. Lost my page. Bear with me for a moment, I apologize. Just writing on it. I know, but it's all these papers. Here it is. Okay, so our next meeting will be Monday, September 26th. It will be held at Roosevelt. The team and I are going to continue to finesse the agenda, as we always do on our Monday morning meetings. We hope to have ratification of the PREA contract for that meeting, where the board will vote to what I hope will be an approval of a new contract. We will be presenting you the Thought Exchange results and showing you the Thought Exchange website, which is coming together very nicely. Dr. Lopez will engage you in a great overview presentation of our new teacher evaluation as well as student growth model. It's been several years of hard work, and it's a document that we're proud of. We're going to look and further the conversation regarding our school nurses, and those are some of the highlights. We've received a number of FOIAs, a few of which were discussed this evening in terms of the tentative agreement. And we are not able, per contract language, to put the contract out for anybody's approval until the PREA has ratified it. So I want to make sure that point is clear. It has not yet been ratified.
The membership has not even met to discuss it yet, so that is still in the works. PTO, PTA president meetings will take place tomorrow. We have an ELF meeting in the near future. We have the Park Ridge Community Fund kickoff meeting being scheduled. We continue to work a lot on safety and security, construction. Dr. Lopez has a number of working committees just moving and grooving already this year. And Bernadette and I will be going to an honorary luncheon with INSPRA this Friday. We won two awards in district. We received a Golden Achievement Award for the 2020 Strategic Vision Plan, branding, and the launch process that we went through. We've also won a regular achievement award in terms of the communication contest entries of the 2015 annual report, our the first ever, and then the e-report as well. So some new accolades in terms of how we're communicating with the larger community as well as just as the district in general. So we're excited about those awards and receiving them.
Speaking of communication, are you going to resurrect or continue your
Superintendent Community Relations Council? Yes, indeed. It is something that Bernadette and I have been talking about, really trying to figure out what our areas of focus will be, but it is something that we hope to get up and running within the next month or so. It's on our list of things that are in the works.
Okay.
Oh, and I just put the principals. I am doing my walk and talks. It's been very nice. I get into the building, see the kids. They're starting to recognize me now, year three, and it's exciting to just kind of see everything in action. Right. It's like being a principal, but you're like a celebrity. Usually they don't recognize you, but now because I just keep nosing around, starting to blend in.
So that's it.
We know
that.
All right.
That's it for me.
Okay. Any further comments by the board? Not hearing any, I'll take a motion to close the meeting.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
Tom will have to stay in detention. Everybody else can go home. Thanks.
Oh, you know what?